This is the life engine. It's the most straightforward Darwinian simulation I have ever seen. Every colored pixel you see is a creature's cell, which always does the exact same thing. Species reproduce, mutate, and die out based on simple rules reflected in gameplay. No complex environmental rules to survival, no hidden populations, and it produces amazing things. But it can't produce this. And for now, neither can Thrive. But this is the goal. And even now, Thrive can generate over 100 species in seconds while factoring in the environmental conditions of dozens of patches. That's hard to do by simulating an entire population of individuals like other games, and will only get tougher as the world of Thrive grows in complexity. Instead, this video is about how to produce life faster than Darwinian evolution can allow. Heads up, I'm going to assume that you made it this far because you have experience playing Thrive and understand the basic game concepts. If not, either get the game, it's free, if you want, or watch Oliver's video, which will also get you up to speed. I'm a leading expert in the field of auto-evology, largely due to having helped make up the field in the first place. The need for this innovation originally comes from the desired game to be called Thrive, in which players would not just watch their own species, but an entire biosphere evolve from a microbe to complex, diverse life, all within a reasonable playtime and on the player's ordinary computer. That is already a serious demand for gameplay innovation, perhaps as difficult as the procedural animation that earned Spore a place in history all those years ago. That challenge is probably why I've been attracted to this problem for the last 2 years. But since I started, I've also discovered a call to understand the real world of biology. They say imitation is the sincerest form of flattery, and nothing makes you appreciate the world like trying to rebuild it from scratch. I have probably spent hours in the last 2 years just staring at lawns, wondering how they can exist. I mean, look at this. Why are these two plants next to each other? How could they possibly have different ecological niches? They're 2 inches away from each other. Why isn't one of you extinct? Let's start with the algorithm we have today. Like all code bases, it's a little bit of a Frankenstein monster, and not precisely what anybody had in mind. There are actually 3 different mechanisms influencing the species in the world around you, although 2 of them aren't really that important, so let's go over them in order of increasing relevance. First, the algorithm we use to make new mutations is actually biased. It rolls the dice to add a new organelle 6 times, times the mutation rate you set in the menu. Meanwhile, every organelle already existing has a chance of getting removed, meaning the expected value of organelles removed is linear with species size, whereas the expected value of organelles added is constant. There's actually some hidden math to make a square root function, but the principle is the same. This means that, even in a world where species were under no pressures whatsoever, there would still be at least an equilibrium size where the odds of randomly getting bigger and randomly getting smaller are exactly equal. I have not tested this hypothesis in-game because I don't want to be wrong. You can think of it as a backup system to keep something from growing so big it crashes your computer. You can think of it that way, but the truth is it was probably an accident from years ago. But it's a happy accident! In spite of everything I've said before, and I'm going to keep saying after, Thrive does use in-game events to power evolution. Just like the player, AI cells suffer population penalties for death and population bonuses for reproduction, and almost getting engulfed for some reason. For a while, this was the only means of evolution in Thrive. As auto-evo developed, however, the evolution of evolution reduced the role of Darwinian mechanics into irrelevance. In the modern game, you would need to kill off hundreds of a specific species to bring it to extinction against the will of auto-evo. If you crank these values way up, though, it's possible to awaken these vestigial evolution genes, which I think is really cool. Finally, of course, is auto-evo, the algorithm that accounts for everything else that happens. In a way, that mystery is a good thing. One of the biggest things I've learned from this work is that when people believe things have purpose, they will find a purpose behind whatever is in front of them. Speaking as God, at least of this universe, it's nice to know that even my mistakes in design will find a place in the story thanks to the creativity of humans. And I encourage players to keep doing it. It's okay to look at an evolution simulation and just use it as food for thought sometimes. But it makes me wonder how much of real biology is made up just because we want answers. I won't be talking about all the other ideas for auto-evo people have put forward over the last decade. It's a lot, and similarly, I'm not sure if my recaps of all these ideas would even be doing the original authors justice. And of course, if it's not in running code, you can't really say anything about it for certain. I have read a lot of it, and while I'm going to be going into my own ideas on this video, I hope the other authors see it as standing on the shoulders of giants, instead of just drowning out the competition. To understand auto-evo, you need to understand heuristic functions. Heuristic functions, in this context, are small, and ultimately arbitrary, bits of code to try to guess how good a species is at something. Since Thrive doesn't simulate individuals, auto-evo needs to be able to make a decision about how successful a species would be. For example, here's a heuristic for measuring the microbe's ability to live off wild compounds found in the environment. The code for this one happens to be very simple. Calculate a score for how efficiently the microbe can turn that compound into glucose or ATP, divide by the amount of energy it uses, and the resulting number is your score. Higher is better. Other heuristics get more complicated, but the principles are the same. All of these functions take in a species and return a number. A higher number is better than a lower number for the same metric, but scores of different functions are not comparable to each other. For example, a species with 20 in the chunk food source isn't twice as good as a species with 10 in the compound food source. In fact, some of these scores are on entirely different scales, but that's okay. With the building blocks in place, how do we piece them together to determine a list of species? In the current algorithm, it looks like this. Every patch contains a set of food sources, each representing one way an organism might obtain energy. Each one carries a heuristic for how efficiently a species could get this food source, and a total energy budget to hand out to some lucky species. Now it's time for every food source to find a favorite species. We line up every species, and our food source gives a score to each one. Next, our food source needs to award some energy. Food sources happen to be very picky. While everybody with more than a score of 0 gets some energy, the best species get disproportionately more than the relative scores might suggest. This is to emulate the competitive exclusion principle, while still giving some room for a generalist species to make it by with a little bit of energy from one food source and a little from another. What do these energy points do? Simple. After all species have collected energy, we divide energy by the size of the species, and that's the population the environment can support. Below a minimum population, you're extinct. How are new species made? First, we make a couple randomly mutated variants of existing species. For each of these species, we add it to a hypothetical ecosystem and run the whole process again. Then we look at the hypothetical population of the hypothetical species, and if it's sufficiently higher than the parent species, it either splits off from or completely replaces the parent. But none of this is why you watch this video. You watch this video because you want to know why auto-evo is so mean. You've made a species. You play the species. You get all the food. You kill all the other species. But evolution still says you get a low number. Why? Well, first, you need an attitude adjustment. The auto-evo predictor just shows you the predicted population, even as your species moves in the world and in the ecosystem. Mice outnumber humans by a lot, but I for one feel our species is doing fine. But don't worry, this is auto-evo's fault too. This algorithm has a lot of problems and is not thinking about many of the things you need to care about as you play. First, at the theoretical level, this algorithm is only concerned by a species' ability to quote-unquote eat, which for organisms other than your mother is not nearly the only necessity of life. For example, there is no consideration for adaptation to predators. I'm sorry to everyone who saw species with butt spikes and chose to believe, but that's not defense. Auto-evo thinks that spike is in the front, and it's a predation adaptation. The more pressing problem is one of size and complexity. This algorithm, like real life, needs to randomly stumble on the next mutation. That's a randomly picked organelle out of the 20 in-game with random position and random rotation. 20 organelles times, say, 4 meaningfully different positions is 80. Add 6 rotations, that's 480. Of those 480 possibilities, there is one that is a spike on the front facing forward. Auto-evo will check 3 out of the 480. It's very hard to prove, but I believe this is a large part of why species in the game seem so random. It's the very same thing that makes it possible to run auto-evo, limits the precision, if you will, of mutations. So, what are some other options? Let me show you something I've been working on to prove my ideas and teach myself a little Godot. Question, why didn't you just do this in Thrive? First off, I did. Second off, I wanted to move beyond the limited world of the tiny, and run experiments on species that need more structure like what Thrive is trying to produce. If you're the kind of person that never reads directions, this demo is available for you right now, links in the description, have fun. For the rest of you, I'll walk you through it. So here's a display of all the species in our starting environment, all one of them. Over here, you can change that environment to see how evolution reacts. To look underneath the hood, go to the Miche Inspector. Here, we have this funny little window describing things for life forms to do. You can click up and down this tree, and at the very bottom, we can see an individual species. This is the Miche. It's kind of like a niche, but not exactly the same model. The Miche is the fundamental building block of this new algorithm. It contains both a heuristic for a single evolutionary pressure a species might experience, and some code for possible mutations that could arise as a result of that pressure. A Miche can also have children, or sub-miches if you will, representing subsections of an ecosystem or scenarios in an organism's life. For example, in this simplified simulation of only plants, every species needs to photosynthesize, which is at the top of the Miche tree. If this looks a lot like a food source, that's because it is. But a step below that, we can see a Miche for avoiding dehydration, which the food source algorithm can't support. Below this, we see a split. In this simulated environment, some plants will live their lives in denser patches of plants, while others will find themselves sprouting in recently burned, flooded, or otherwise newly uncolonized areas. The plants in these environments will face different challenges to reach dominance. Are these two distinct niches that will be filled by separate species? That's hard to tell. But now, they are two different Miches. At the very bottom, we see species occupying spots on the tree. For now, both available spots are held by the same species, which is the only one in the world. Later, we'll see a variety of species occupying these slots. Note that this tree of Miches is not the same as the tree of ancestry we commonly think of in evolution. Instead of being closely related, species close in this tree are surviving in similar ways. Every leaf node on the tree might be occupied by a species, or might be left empty. A species can claim more than one, but any species that wants to survive needs to have at least one. This tree structure isn't just a flimsy way to connect all these Miches. Anytime we need to find a new place for a species, we start from the top and work down. We run the heuristic at the top level, against any species already inside the Miche. If our new candidate is better than at least one, it proceeds down the tree. If it isn't, then there's no place in this Miche for the new species. If our candidate species makes it to the bottom, then it takes the spot. This might take a spot from somebody else, which might drive that other species to extinction. This procedure happens many times in this simulation. For example, if you change the environment settings, that generates a whole new and different Miche. To survive, everybody on the old Miche needs to jump ship. So where do new species come from? We've watched them die, but when in this algorithm are species born? Every generation, the environment influences all species. We take a look at every unique path down the tree that ends in a species. If multiple paths terminate in the same species because a species is holding multiple leaf nodes, then that means that species is being pulled in multiple directions by the mutation process, which might split the species. For each path, we travel down and the Miche adds potential variants and test them just against the higher layers. Any changes that help more than they hurt get to continue the process. The rest are thrown out immediately. This is critical. By constantly pruning the possibilities, this algorithm can avoid that spiral of complexity that the food source algorithm cannot. When we get to the bottom, the best surviving variant is not added to the bottom of the Miche. It's taken all the way back up to the top and inserted like any other species. You never know if this new species is going to be the best fit for something else. And that's really it. There's more details, but they're likely to change. Even what I said might not be true by the time you watch this. If you have questions, feel free to ask. I'm not nearly famous enough to blow off my comments section. Personally though, I've already got two questions for myself. First, is this real evolution? The mutations are heavily biased by the code. Are they still random? The selection is based on the code I wrote. Is that natural selection? Species have ancestry, but without individuals, does that count?
I've got a chart, is it science now?
Second, and more important, does any of this work? To me, the answer is the same for both. I don't know. Let's find out. I'm an engineer at heart, not a scientist. I don't put my faith in long mathematical proofs I wouldn't even know if they're correct. My only god is the on button. For the time being, I want to keep working on this tech demo. With the framework in place, I want to keep adding complexity until it's beyond what any other life simulation can pull off. But even before then, have a go with the environment sliders. See what you can bring into this tiny little world. Can you maximize the number of unique species? Can you get the chunky leaf? How about the chunky stem? How about the pointy tree? The extra pointy tree? I even added a little bug simulator for Pokemon-like encounters, but where you, like, fight grass? So I'm adding this bit on the end because I've changed perspective since starting this project. It's up to you, but I think I've got something here. I've really been diving into the encounter system lately, and I think there's a recipe here for a different take on a creature survival game than we've seen before. Meanwhile, the reason I had time to do all this lately is that I was recently laid off. With the employment market for software developers being the way it is right now, no one's begging me to go code for them like they were back in the good old days. So it seems like the universe, specifically the demand curve of the labor market, is telling me it's a good time to become a game dev. But I'm still a little bit of a scientist at heart, so I want to know what the data is telling me. So here's the plan. I put up a tech demo on Itch for all of you to look at. If nobody cares and no one's even going to play it for free, I swallow my pride and get a real job. If I see plays, and I see views, and I think this can work, then I make a real game. I don't plan on doing any kind of early access, or Patreon, or anything like that. Win or lose, this is going to be a short-term endeavor. If I can't get this game out in a few months, I just don't sell it, and you don't buy it. And I do plan to sell it. Thrive is still free, this is gameplay that would never fit into Thrive on an unrelated codebase. And don't worry. I'm going to keep doing Thrive stuff in my free time, and Thrive will keep chugging along at the pace it always has. So yeah, let me know. I've now got the time if you guys have the interest.